population genetics is that of a selective sweep, where a beneficial mutation arises at some point in time, sweeps to high frequency, dragging along its genetic background with it. Right here we see an amazing illustration of this process in the HIV population within a patient, where a drug resistance mutation arose and swept quickly to fixation, reducing most of the diversity across the genome. Now in populations where there's more recombination, not all genetic diversity is lost, because recombination exchanges genetic backgrounds between the haplotypes. And here we see the loss of genetic diversity at the selected site, but then this recovers, creating these characteristic dips in diversity. Similarly, at the selected site, we see these very star-like phylogenies, where with one sample's alleles in the present day, they all quickly coalesce back to the beneficial mutation, whereas recombination allows alleles that link neutral sites to coalesce further back in the past. However, this is still a skew in the gene genealogies as expected under neutrality, which leads to skews in the site frequency spectrum, which then leads to signatures in the summary statistics of the site frequency spectrum, such as strongly negative to genus D around the selected site due to an excess of high frequency and low frequency mutations caused by these gene genealogies. Okay, so while in the HIV case, we got to actually see the sweep occur, in many cases, we just have extant genomes, but we can use these signatures of selection to scan across these genomes and look for sites that may have had selective sweeps occur in the past. And so this has been very successful, for instance, in locating resistance loci in the malaria parasite Plasmodium, as well as insecticide resistance loci in Drosophila, where we see these characteristic dips in diversity. Now, the three cases I gave you are interesting in the fact that they're drug resistance, insecticide resistance. Not only do we have very strong selection, but we also have very strong stressors, right? And in fact, these have all been created, these situations have been created by humans to cause population declines and ideally eradication. And so we have this scenario where we expect population sizes to be climbing, but resistance has arisen and evolution has rescued populations from extinction. Right? And again, HIV is a great case where we have so much data, we actually see these demographies where population size declines, but a resistance mutation allele spreads and the population recovers and persists. And what I find especially interesting about this process is that there's this intricate feedback between demography and evolution here, where the sweep affects the bottleneck and the bottleneck affects the sweep. And what I want to do today is ask, what are the genetic signatures that this feedback between demography and evolution, what genetic signatures does this feedback allow in the case of evolutionary rescue? Okay, so to do this, we're going to build a simple one locus, two allele model, where we have and assign absolute fitnesses to these genotypes. So we're thinking of a case where we have a little a genotype that is declining at some rate B. We're then going to think of a big A allele as conferring some selective benefit, allowing this genotype to grow, have an absolute fitness above replacement. We're going to consider the additive case where the big A just has twice the selective benefit. And I'm going to only talk about the simplest scenario here, where we can consider a population composed primarily of little a, the wild type, and rare standing genetic variation, one or a handful of big A alleles present at the onset of environmental change. So we're getting rescued from rare standing genetic variation. Right, so we can use this model to predict allele frequency dynamics over time. As well as population size dynamics over time. And we can overlay simulations here using SLIM3 and see that we're doing a good job in capturing mean dynamics. We can also compare our rescue case to the case of constant population size and and see that when we condition on rescue, these sweeps are expected to occur a little earlier and a little faster. Okay, so those are the forward time dynamics. Now, to predict the genetic signatures that these processes leave in genomes, we need to put on our coalescence glasses and think backwards in time. So before we were going forward in time, this slide's gonna be backwards in time, right to left. And so here's the case of the constant population size, the sweep, and the population size. And given these dynamics, we can calculate the rates of coalescence and recombination in a given generation T, given that we have K lineages present in that generation. And in the case of K equals 2, sample sizes of 2, is particularly simple, and we can just ask, what's the probability, if we look at a linked neutral site shown here in blue, that these two alleles coalesce with one another before either of them recombines off the selected background? Or what's the probability that one of these blue alleles recombines off before they coalesce? And in the case of the constant population size, starting on the right, we're going to see that most of the recombination occurs before most of the coalescence occurs. But if we compare that to the case of evolutionary rescue, this bottleneck that occurs in the middle of the sweep pushes coalescence closer to the present day and thus reduces the amount of recombination that we get off these selected backgrounds. And this is for a particularly strong selection coefficient, but we can ask what happens when we say turn down the strength of selection. And in this case, while in the constant population size case, there's now more time for recombination to occur, and we get more recombination off, in the case of rescue, turning down the selection coefficient also broadens and deepens the bottleneck because of this feedback between demography and evolution. They're not independent of one another. And so we actually see little changes in the amounts of recombination in rescue, leading to larger differences between these two scenarios. Okay, so then we can use these K equals 2 results to directly predict these dips in diversity across the genome around the selected site. So here I'm showing the prediction in the case of a constant population size, where we have this dip here and a background level of genetic diversity shown with the dashed line. We can layer on our predictions under rescue, and we can again compare to simulations. And we see that we're doing a decent job in capturing these dynamics again, and there's little difference between the models under this strong selection coefficient. It's primarily a slightly wider dip in rescue due to this excess of coalescence. But really no effect genome-wide because these bottlenecks are occurring on a time scale that is quite short relative to coalescence. So we actually would say we maybe don't detect any demography here, and we might overestimate S, say, just due to these slightly wider dips. Okay, and then if we look at the case of the weaker selection, in the constant case, these dips get narrower because there's more time for recombination. But under rescue, this bottleneck has prevented the dip from getting smaller. So we see larger differences there. We also see now a detection of the longer, deeper bottleneck in the case of rescue. And so here we might actually be able to guess that there was some demography has happened. Okay, so I haven't had a chance to do the math for the cases of K larger than 2 yet, but I want to show you some simulations of Tajima's D, which I think are particularly interesting. Under the strong selection, we see that in both rescue and the constant population size, we have no effect near the sweep. They both show negative Tajima's D at the selected site. But the Tajima's D is much more sensitive to detecting demography and picks up this bottleneck, showing positive Tajima's D in the background in the case of rescue and not in the case of constant. This leads to a greater overall magnitude differences in to genus D as we in the case of rescue. And when we turn down selection, we again see a little effect near the sweep, but a detection of the even larger bottleneck, leading to even larger magnitude differences in the case between the two cases. Okay, so the simple story that I wanted to communicate with you guys today is that in cases where there's strong selection and strong stresses, there's not only likely to be differences in relative fitness, but also differences in absolute fitness. And this leads to feedbacks between demography and evolution, as is characteristic of evolutionary rescue. And these feedbacks then impose constraints on the genetic patterns that we expect to see, where one cannot impose independently a demography and a selection coefficient when they're trying to think about these problems, but the two are intertwined. And so while I've talked about rescue from rare standing genetic variation, we've also been exploring this by rescue by new mutation, recurrent mutation, by rescue by migration, as well as rescue by soft selective sweeps. We've started to investigate how population, what genetic signatures are left behind when populations colonize new habitats in a related process. And I think there are many scenarios for us as evolutionary biologists to think about things in this more eco-evolutionary framework and then ask what kind of constraints does that put on the patterns that we expect to see. And so I'm excited to continue this kind of research program going forward, starting in Toronto in a year and a half. So if anyone's interested in getting involved, interacting with me, please come find me at some point today. And with that, I'd like to thank Graham Koop, especially, and everybody in the Koop Lab for their support, as well as UC Davis and Canada for funding. Thank you very much. The bottleneck signal should extend genome-wide. It's, I've just shown it kind of near the sweep here, but yeah, ideally you're looking far away from that, but if you just average over everything, that should give you kind of the genome-wide signal.